Good afternoon. The first session after lunch. Hopefully we have enough interesting topics to cover to keep you all awake, of course. So OAuth 2, a standard that we think will become more and more important over time. As we, I'm actually a practitioner. My name is Stan van der Linde. I work for ACA IT Solutions. I'm the CTO of the company. We're a software company making made-to-measure software. And we see from our business perspective an evolution, of course, to more richer applications being either iPad, iPhone, or Android native applications, or a shift to more rich web applications. So where we had, let's say, 3 or 4 or 5 years ago, the main focus on, let's say, the TIC server model, where we had a server actually serving just HTTP requests back to the client. This is totally changed over time, where we now have a REST backend with really a thin server model with a TIC client in front using technology such as a Backbone or Angular, real JavaScript-based front-end frameworks. And with that shift, there is also a set of challenges coming in, and OAuth fits quite nicely in that picture. So we think that although OAuth is already widely adopted in the industry, so if you want to use services from Facebook, Google, or whatever, you probably will be using OAuth. It will even become more important because that kind of applications are really becoming the standard. So also from an application development perspective, OAuth will become a lot more important. I will not be doing this presentation alone, so Jan.
Okay, I'm Jan van den Berg, I'm a colleague of Stijn at ACA IT Solutions. My background is mainly security and identity and access management. And I also do Java application development and integration solutions. I first would like to give an example of why we use OAuth. Probably you have already heard of a valid key for cars. It's more popular in the States, and there you often, if you go to a hotel, there's someone who parks your car for you. But of course you don't want that person to go joyriding with your car or take stuff out of your trunk. And to do that, there's a special key that you get with your car, a valid key. And it only gives limited access to your car. You cannot open the glove box, you cannot open the trunk, you cannot go speeding with it. And the valid key, in fact, gives only a limited scope to the car, to the person who will park it. And in fact, OAuth does the same. So what you do is delegated authorization for web applications. And what that means is you give someone else a permission to do some things on your name. So for instance, he can use your contacts in Google, but he cannot do anything else. And if you go back 10 years or so, when LinkedIn was first developed, if you then wanted to add all your contacts to LinkedIn, you had to give your username and password to Google. And LinkedIn would then go on your behalf to Google, use your contacts and import all those people. But of course, with these credentials, LinkedIn could also access your mail, even send mail on your behalf, and that's something that you typically don't want to do. So with the introduction of OAuth, that's no longer possible, and you can say to Google, okay, LinkedIn can access my account, it can access my contacts, but it cannot do anything else anymore. When was LinkedIn first developed? So we'll first give an overview of the timeline. And in fact, it started in 2007, when Twitter, Magnolia, they saw the same problem and they wanted a solution for that. So they started a special interest group to find a solution. A few months later, Google also joined the group. And the result was that a couple of months later, in October 2007, there was a final draft of the OAuth Core 1.0 standard. And it was already implemented by these parties. Unfortunately, these implementations were not very good. They were all different, and it was not very easy to use them all at the same time. So each implementation had its own peculiarities, which had to be addressed when you wanted to use them. Then later on, the Internet Engineering Task Force also became interested in OAuth. And by 2010, it became an RFC, RFC 5849. So it became an internet standard that was also adopted by more and more services that wanted to use it. And then they started working on OAuth 2.0. And it is, at the moment, it is RFC 6749. It has been for a long time under development. I believe there have been 31 draft versions of it. And as a consequence of that, you will see that there are some service providers that, for instance, implement draft version 12 and others implement draft version 23. And those are not all the same. So in some cases, you have to use different types of data to speak to the service provider. But hopefully now that it has been finalized, this will all go, will all dim out, and we will get one standard that can be used by everyone. OAuth is there to address a very specific problem, authorization. So I will try to compare it with a few other protocols that are open and used on the internet, and that typically only look for identification and authentication. And the first protocol that is being widely used is SAML, which is also at the moment at version 2.0. SAML uses an XML vocabulary to assert to another party that the user is who he claims he is. And that can be a user ID that is given, but also other claims can be passed as well. For instance, you get a service provider can ask, is this person older than 18? And SAML can give you an answer to that. So there's an assertion to say that. That makes it also possible to limit the scope of what you want to tell to the other party. If you only want to give your age, that's possible. If you only want to give your email address, that's also possible. SAML is a very complex and very strict protocol to use. And part of the complexity is because it uses XML plus digital signatures to express the assertion. And digital signatures in XML, they are very easy from concept, but to get them implemented correctly and to let them work, it's a bit of another story, so it's not that easy. And what's also important about SAML is that it's based on mutual trust. So there is in fact a PKI-like structure that has to be set up so that you can trust an identity provider if you want to accept the identities. One important aspect is that SAML has a very good interoperability. So if you have two completely different providers, most of the times they can speak with each other. Other standards don't have that flexibility. And the main reason is because it's a strict protocol and the XML signatures. So once they work, it will work across a number of providers. An alternative to SAML is OpenID. OpenID is a more lightweight protocol. Authentication happens via URL, so your identity is in fact a URL. And that's in fact what it does primarily. There are also a number of extensions, so you can pass other attributes to the service provider, for instance, your email address or your age. And instead of a trust relationship, OpenID uses discovery. So if you go to a service provider that needs your identity, you typically enter your OpenID URL, or for some providers it already knows it. If you use Google, for instance, typically the service provider already knows the URL. And then the service provider will talk to the identity provider to discover who you are and what your properties are. These two protocols, SAML and OpenID, they only talk about identification and authentication, so about who the person is. But sometimes when you want to do something in the name of that person, that is not possible. And that's why there was need for the OAuth protocol. So here we can express that a service provider is allowed to do things in our name. Access our calendar or things like that. OAuth is also a lightweight protocol. It also uses the well, very basic HTTP protocol to do that. Something that is not included in the protocol is the way how the relationship is built. So if you build an application and you want to use OAuth, there is no protocol, no standard protocol that you can go to Google and immediately connect with it. You first have to go as a developer to Google, to the Google Developer Console, and say, I have an application here and I want to connect with you and I want to connect these services. And then Google will give you a few identifiers and you can use those to identify yourself with Google and you can continue working then. And as I mentioned earlier, for OAuth there are a number of implementations and they are all a little bit different. So if you want to talk to Twitter or you want to talk to Google, well, each time you have to check that your implementation works and sometimes you have to tweak a few things to let it work correctly. Then if we go to OAuth 2, there have been a few changes compared to OAuth 1. One important change is that OAuth 2 speaks about the number of flows, and we will talk about those flows later in more detail, depending on what kind of application you are. So if you are a web application, you use one flow. If you are a JavaScript application, you use another flow. And these flows, they are optimized for each of these types of applications. And the second difference compared to OAuth 1.0 is that OAuth 2 uses bearer tokens. And a bearer token is a string that you get. Well, it's often impossible to see what's in that string. And you can give it to a service, and the service will identify you based on that string. And there is no extra need for cryptography to prove who you are. You just give the string to the service, and it will do what you ask it to do. This is also something that a lot of people complain about, because it's too easy. If someone else can intercept the bearer token, of course, he can do things in your name. Fortunately, the protocol will make sure that the bearer tokens are only valid for a limited time. So after, for instance, 1 hour, you will have to get another bearer token, and then you can, the older one is not valid anymore. And also here, the implementations are differ between the different service providers, and that's mainly because of the different versions of the draft that have been implemented by them. So here you can find a number of services that already use OAuth. You will see here that Twitter is in fact missing. That's because Twitter is still on OAuth version 1.0. They probably will also change in the future, but well, it's something of course that they have to invest money in, and that's also something that's not very easy often. You can also see, for instance, Facebook is still stuck on version 2.0, but draft 12. And you will also see when we look at the examples that that has certain implications about when you want to access it. And most of the others are already on version 2.0 with small changes here and there. Okay, so now we'll talk about the main part of OAuth, the different flows. And we will also give you an example about how you can implement them yourselves.
So as Jan already mentioned, the idea of a flow is that it serves a specific use case. And we'll be covering the four main flows that are in the specification. Nevertheless, some providers actually have specific flows for specific use cases. So I'll cover that in the end, but Google, for example, has a device flow. That is a specific flow for use cases where you have a device that you want to authenticate to things on your behalf, but you don't have the possibility to give input on that device. So let's say a television set that you want to get access to, say, a Twitter account, but you don't have a keyboard or whatever input device to get on that device. For that specific use case, there are also specific flows available. But these are the main flows or grant types that are specified in the specification. Let's start with the what I think is the most important and also the most complex one, is the server-side web application flow. So the typical use case for this flow is I have a user that is using an application, and that user wants to give this application the right to access particular resource at a resource provider. So let's say I'm developing an iPhone application, but I'm also developing a backend service for that iPhone application. And I want to give this iPhone application the possibility to access, let's say, photos or contacts at Google, my resource provider. So this is a typical use case of this kind of flow. So I, as a user, want to give another application the possibility to access a particular resource on my behalf. That's our main use case here. Now, how does this actually work? So I, as a user, I'm in this case using my browser as an example. And I want, my application gives me a clear indication that the application wants to get access to a particular resource at my resource provider. And I, as a user, I say, okay, I want to go through the process to give my application indeed this access right to that particular resource. So the user indicates that he or she has the intention to allow an application to access a particular resource at that particular provider. So what actually happens is my application will construct a redirect, and that redirect contains quite some information. So it will contain, of course, the path to the authentication server at the resource provider, because that's what I will be redirecting to in order to give the application access to that particular resource. It will contain, a client ID identifying my application. And as Jan already mentioned in the introduction, this client ID is something that has to be retrieved offline. So I, as an application owner, I have to register my application at Google, for example, and I'll get a client ID and a client secret from Google. And with that, I also have to register my redirect URL. And I'll explain you what this redirect URL is in a minute and why it's important that it's registered offline. And if you don't register that properly, it's a serious security threat. So, but what I have is, I have a client ID that identifies my application at the resource provider site. That's the idea of the client ID. The redirect URI, that's the URI that I want the resource provider to direct the user to after successful granting this application access to my resource. And then have a scope. And the scope defines what the application wants to access at the resource provider site. Meaning, for example, wants to be able to read user information, wants to be able to read an email address, wants to be able to edit contacts, whatever. So the scope actually defines what rights that this application will actually be granted. So that's very important. That's something that we don't have with username and passwords. If I, in the LinkedIn example of many years back, when I had granted LinkedIn or Google the access to, let's say, access my LinkedIn, or LinkedIn the LinkedIn access to my Google account, it will be a full scoped access. With the scope, I can just limit what the actual application can do at the resource provider site. So that's a very good thing. And normally it's a list of space delimited strings. For example, Facebook, still stuck at draft 12, uses a semicolon delimited list for this. But that's just a nuance that you have to take care when implementing integration with Facebook. But the idea is that you have a set of URNs or a set of URLs that define the scope clearly. And then last but not least, we have this is still one coming. We have the response type, identifying the flow that I'm in. In this case, it's authorization code, because that identifies my flow here. And then I have a state, and that state is kept of generated server side, so at the application side, and will be passed around. And that's also a very important parameter in order to prevent an attacker from interfering in this flow. So what will happen is, with this redirect, the data will get sent to the resource provider's authentication server. And the resource provider authentication server will, of course, first need to authenticate the user. For example, I'm going to Google. Google doesn't know me because I'm not authenticated yet. So I have to log in into Google using just my Google credentials, username and password. And after this authentication, Google will prompt me with a page indicating if it's okay that I grant this particular application this particular access based on the codes that I sent to Google. Let's say I say no, I don't want to give this application access. Then I go into the error path, and of course, the resource provider authentication server will redirect or send a redirect through the browser containing all the information with regard to the error. So how does he know where to redirect to? Because I defined the redirect URL when issuing my original request. Remember, that's one of the parameters I was sending to the resource provider site. So when I say no, the resource provider will just redirect me back to this URI, to this URL, I mean, with some extra information with regard to this error. So I'm not going into full detail here, but in my case where I said, no, I don't want to give this particular application access to this resource, I would get an access denied. Showing that, of course, my resource owner has denied access to that particular resource. I then, as an application, can use this error code to make sure that I display the right message again to the user, begging him to get access, please, because otherwise my application will, for example, not work. I will also get back the state, an optional error description, and an optional error URI. This description is just extra information on the error. The URI is actually just a URL where I can redirect the user, or the user can click on, to get more information on this particular error at the resource provider site. It's just building trust here. That's actually what we're doing. Just to make sure that you have the mental image of this, we're sending back the state as well, so that the application that will, of course, get this data can correlate this error message to the original request going to the resource provider. And that's very important. Okay. Maybe stranger, I start with the error, but error is in this case the easy part. So let's assume that I said, yes, I want to give this application access to this particular resource. Then the server at the resource provider will construct a redirect that contains an authorization code. This is just a string, a code. And, of course, again, this state. What will happen is my browser will, of course, redirect to the application server. And, of course, this is just sent to the application server. And the application server will have to trade in the authorization code to an access token, because the authorization code doesn't give anything. It's just actually an identifier of the response, the conversation I had as a user had with the resource provider. That's how you should think about it. So that identifies this conversation and whether I said yes or no. So what happens is the application will construct a post to the resource provider containing the authorization code, the redirect URI, and an identifier of the grant type that's just saying that he's sending an authorization code in. And he will get back as a return a token. Of course, it's very important that the application also identifies itself at the resource provider side, so that the resource provider knows who's actually asking for a trading of this authorization code to a token. So that's why you see here in the header, you see just a basic authentication going on, containing as ways to authenticate the application, username and the password. And username is the client ID and the password is the client secret that the application retrieved when registering itself at the resource provider side. So with that, the authentication server at the resource provider knows who's actually trading in this authorization code. What will happen next is when successful, of course, the resource provider authentication server, and that's, yes.
No, I'm a bit worried about this because this first seems to be coming from the application server of your application.
That's true. So it's not the client anymore.
So how did he get hold of my password?
He didn't.
That's what I thought.
It's not your
password,
isn't it? The application itself.
So it's the application's password. It's an identification of the application so that the resource provider authentication server knows who's actually requesting for the trading.
Because in fact I authenticated just before I got the...
You as a user authenticated at the authentication server side, but that's a completely different flow from the flow that I'm now in.
Yeah, but that resulted in the, to make you recap, that resulted in the...
authorization code coming back. But I never saw a password of you or whatever, because otherwise we would defeat the purpose of OAuth. So what I get back when this is successful is actually the access token. And the access token will be used in order to do the real calls to the resource provider. So that's the thingy that I want. So that's my valet key as a metaphor that Jan explained. So I now did the entire interaction to get a valet key in return, actually. And this token is time limited. It expires, in this case, it expires in an hour. And it has a token type. In this case, it's just a bearer token. With that, I can also get back a refresh token. And that token has a different purpose. It gives me the possibility that after expiration of the access token, to get a new valid access token. That's the idea of the refresh. Because again, I'm an application sitting in the middle, and my user is doing whatever he wants to do, and I, of course, want to still have API access over time. So for that, I have my refresh token. I can trade in the refresh token for a new access token, whatever I want. That's the idea. So, going in the wrong direction here. So with that, I now have a correct access token. So I can start calling the API at the resource provider site. Very simple, I just had an authorization header to my HTTP, whatever call I do. Let's say I'm just retrieving data, so I'm doing a GET call. I'm just sending this access token as a HTTP authorization header. And of course, my resource provider will have to validate whether this is a correct access token. So what he'll have to do is check at the authorization server, authentication server, security service at the resource provider side, whether this access token is valid. If yes, okay, I'll get a response. and my HTTP call, REST call is returned, and I have data. So that's cool. So with the entire flow, I now have an access token. This access token is actually passed around between the application and the resource provider's implementation. Let's suppose that the access token is not valid anymore. What happens then? I get a for whatever response code containing information on what the actual error is. And in this regard, the specification is quite flu. So there is no real, very hard definition on how you should define error. But at least it says that if there is an error, an indication of the error, this field should be accessible under the name error. That's as far as the specification actually goes. So what I get back, the application side is a for whatever, and an error code indicating what went wrong. So for example, when I'm using Facebook, I get something like this. If the access token is not valid, I get something of type or out access or out exception on as a JSON error entry. For Google, for example, I get a list of errors within the errors indicating actually what went wrong, etc., etc. So, but at least as an application, from an application point of view, I have a clear understanding of what went wrong, and I can act based on that. One of the, of course, most common use cases is that my access token is no longer valid. So that my 1 hour validity of my access token expired, and I have to trade it in for the refresh token, if it's available, for a new access token. And again, what I'll do from an application perspective is I'll just post some data containing again or authenticated again using my client ID and client secret, sending in the refresh token that I got earlier, and indicating that I'm sending in a refresh token and I want again a new access token. And of course, as you can guess, what I get in return is a new access token with a new validity, and maybe, depending on the implementation, a new refresh token that I, again, then can trade in for a new access token when this access token actually expires. Now, with this entire flow, there are, of course, some security considerations, right? The first thing is that, as Jan explained, the bearer token is just an opaque string. So whoever can get access to the access token will get access to the actual resource at the resource provider side. So it makes sense, of course, to do the entire communication based on secure protocol. So OAuth says, okay, the transport itself should be secure. So we're doing all the interactions here on top of TLS SSL. So that it, at least the interaction is secure. What you also saw here, and that's also very important to understand, is you see the redirect ping-pong going on. And it's also very important that when I, as an application, first register, that I define also my redirect URL correctly. So I get, when I register myself as an application, I also have to provide a redirect URL. Suppose that this redirect URL or my resource provider is not really that strict on the redirect URL, then a particular hacker could very easily create his own redirect URL, and instead of redirecting this authorization code to my application, I'm redirecting this authorization code to whatever application the hacker is registering. So for that, also the request URL should be properly monitored and should be validated at the resource provider side, whether indeed this client is using the correct redirect URL in order to send data back. Another important aspect is actually the state. So what you saw here in this slide is when initiating the original request is that my application was actually identifying the request using a state. And it's important that whenever something comes back from the resource provider, that it is correlated to the right state again. Why is that important? Let's suppose that we don't do it. That's the easy way to explain. So let's suppose that we're not checking the state, and I'm a hacker, and I see some of you accessing or going through this flow on Twitter, as an imaginary example. Then for me, it's very easy, when you're doing the interaction, to just send an authorization code that I get from Twitter to the application. What will happen is the application will go with that authorization code through the entire process, and it will couple your account that you are registering to my Twitter account as a hacker. And that's not what I want, because I want, of course, also confidentiality on the information, right? Let's say that I'm sending specific information to my resource provider, for example, account information of my bank, then, of course, I, as a hacker, I would find it very interesting to get that information on my account at the resource provider, and I can just log in and get this information from them. So therefore, it's important that you have the state correctly captured and correctly validated. And that's also, that's one of the main problems that we had with auth providers not really sticking to the protocol, that it is important to validate the redirect URI and the state. Otherwise, this protocol is extremely vulnerable to attacks.
I think I can see the redirect, the importance of the redirect URI. So, with respect to the state, isn't that taken care of by the fact that you're using a synchronous protocol?
No, it's not a synchronous protocol. We are actually piggybacking using the browser redirect, so it's completely asynchronous. But the fact that I'm sending as an application a redirect makes it completely asynchronous. It's the browser that will then, it's always passing through the browser.
Right, yeah. But so the requests are always synchronous, are always made synchronous.
Yes.
So the browser should know which request he's redirecting.
Well, the browser actually knows which request he's redirecting, but doesn't maintain any state on that.
I see.
Maybe just because I just to make sure that everybody understands correctly. So what actually happens here in this first request is this actually creates the authorization grant, let's say, right? And what comes back is this one, yeah, a code that can be traded in for an access token, yeah. So this one, this call, is a very important one.
Right.
Yeah. If I, as a hacker, would be able to just interfere here and make sure that instead of this redirect with this particular authorization code, I'm injecting my authorization code, then what will happen here at the application side, as is instead of creating an access token for the user, it will be creating an access token for the hacker. So the user's account will get associated with the account of the hacker instead of the user account of the user. You can say, okay, that's a problem for the hacker then, that he has the account link with the user. No. It's a problem for the user, because with that, of course, the hacker can get a lot of information on behalf of the user, actually. Does that explain it more clearly?
I think so. But so the vulnerability would have to be on the side of the resource.
No, it's at the browser side, actually.
So they need to be on both sides?
No, it isn't. Because the resource provider doesn't know anything about the user. Well, actually, he knows something about the user. The fact that the problem is a bit that the state is actually never sent to the authorization server, right? So the only thing that the authorization server knows is actually the user, because the user authenticated, and a code that is associated with this user. He doesn't know anything about the state of the interaction itself. He just knows that the application has asked for access on behalf of a particular user. If the hacker does exactly the same, there is no difference for the authorization server whether it's the hacker or the user. He just sees the request. So therefore, it's important that the application validates whether the user is actually initiating the request and that he's associated the access token with the request initiated by the user. So then the cycle is complete. Any other questions? Because this is really the most difficult flow. All the rest will just be subsets of
more of the same.
Yeah, more of the same. So if you get this, you're there. All more or less clear? Okay. So let's go back. So what's important to know, it's a bit annoying. Where are we here? So what's important here to know is that the access token, and this access token is really important because it will authorize my API request, right? So the access token is really my gold egg, right? This access token is never sent through the browser. So the user doesn't know the access token. That's very important because let's say that we can protect our application better than the user's browser, right? So the access token is really very specific. The access token is also very short-lived. So it only lives for whatever seconds or minutes that are defined. So even if an attacker can, let's say, get a hold on the access token, it might even be so that it's already long expired. And the state parameter actually prevents the attack that I just explained previously. The refresh tokens are a different problem actually, because the refresh tokens are long-lived. I, as an application, have a refresh token, and I can trade it in for an access token whenever I want. So it's very important to secure that correctly. And because I'm an application, I'll be storing refresh tokens on behalf of all the users of the application. So it actually becomes an interesting point for attackers to attack, right? Because if they get hold on the refresh token, they can get hold on access tokens for all the subsequent, for all the users actually. So it's very important to store them, of course, properly. So as an application provider, make sure you do this, otherwise you'll be in the news soon. Certainly if your application becomes heavily used. So. From an implementation perspective, Jan?
Okay, so I will quickly try to implement this. Please note the implementation that I will write here in 10 minutes will not be production quality code, so just don't take that and use that in your own application. In fact, for your own application, you probably should go look for a client library and use that instead, because they are properly implemented. Okay, let me first show you a bit about the setup of the project. So it will be Java because, well, that's what our company does most and we know it the best. There are a few components that I will be using to do this, so an HTTP client library, the common Slang project, because it offers some functionality that's very easy to use, and then also the Google JSON implementation to parse some JSON strings. I also have written some utilities of myself, some shortcuts to send HTTP methods, and also a method to parse JSON. Okay, so I will first start with the first part of the flow, and that is I have to send a redirect to my OAuth provider, and I do that to get an authorization code. So I will start with building the URI. Hope it works. And the URI I use is the one for Google. I have a number of constants also in a class that contain everything I need. And the one I need is the Google authentication URI. So that's in fact this value. So other constants I have for Google is the token service URI and also a client ID and a client secret. You can all write down the client secret because I will be revoking it after the session. So you can not use it anymore. Okay, also as Stan mentioned, first thing to do is you have to add a state to the URL. And that state should not be easily guessable. So it should not be possible by an attacker to guess the state, because then they can do the attack that Stan mentioned earlier. So there are utilities for that to create a random string. So say I want a random string with both letters and numbers. I also need it later when the request comes back, so I have to put it on the session for a while. And then I have to add it to the URL. So I add the state also to the URL. So that's the first parameter. Then I also need to redirect URL, so the URL back into our application after the authorization code was created. I don't want to import the correct class. So in fact, what this utility will do, it will create an absolute URL for our application to the GSP that I added there. It's a bit tricky to do that with a Java Servlet API, so I create a utility for that.
This URL is pre-registered at the resource provider side.
Yes.
Although some are less strict on that. So some just will also respond, let's say I'm redirecting to www.app.com and I just registered www.app.com. And I redirect to /whatever, some resource provider will accept /whatever. So that's a security problem. Because if I'm somewhere on that domain, I can get a redirect using that server, and I can hack that server out. I can, of course, bypass the entire security. So make sure you check that first.
Okay, I'm now also adding the other required parameter, so my client ID that identifies my application to Google. I say I want a code as the response type, so not something else. Then I also have to add a scope. The scopes I add here are shortcuts used by Google to say that I want to access the profile service and to access the email address of the user. Normally you use URNs, but it is harder to type. And the last parameter is specific for Google as well. And this makes sure that Google will always ask me my permission So it's also possible to let Google cache that. So if you often use the same application, you want to say Google, okay, if that client application asks for my calendar, always grant it, that's possible. But then the example would not be as good, so that's why I add this. And then I convert that to a string, and well, here below you can see that I have a link with that URL in it. So let's now see if it builds and wants to run. So in fact, I'm using the Maven Jetty plugin to quickly start an application server and test this out. So I want the server-side web application flow. I want to log in with Google, so that creates the URL we just done. Google, well, I have already authenticated before with Google with my ACA email address, my ACA account. So I don't have to do that anymore, but Google still asks me that the application wants to access basic information about my account and my email address. Then I can say allow access, and then I come back in the redirect page. Well, that redirect page doesn't contain any code yet, so I get null as a result. And in fact, what we get here, so we have the parameter state, and that's also the state that was randomly created to go to Google. And we also have the code parameter, and that's the authorization code that can then later be traded in for an access token. So, okay, let's now try to do that. So now the hardest part has been done. If you do something wrong in these parameters, then, well, you won't get here, of course. So then the next part is in fact that I work with the information that comes back from Google. And first what I absolutely need to do is verify the state. And the state that comes in from Google is a parameter with name state. So simply get it. The state that I expect is on the session, so I just get it back out. I can safely cast that to a string because I know it was a string I put there. And then, of course, I have to check that those are the same. So if they're not the same, I will just send an error back to the user. That incoming request and invalid state. And simply enter flow here. So normally I can already try that. Now it says invalid state, so probably the state was lost on the session or something. So normally if we do the flow again later on, it will work. Okay, then the next part is that I have to get the access token back from Google. So to do that, I have to send the request to the token service. And for that, I use the HTTP client library. So the first request that was sent to Google by my browser. It was a redirect flow. But now my application itself will need to send the request to Google. So it's not going through the browser anymore. So the first parameter I will have to add is the grant type. And the grant type is what I use to get the access token. So the other flows use different grant types. Here I use authorization code because that's what I got back from the user. And then I also have to add, of course, the code itself. And that's also a request parameter. Then I also have to pass my client ID and my client secret. So the client ID is so that Google knows that it's still the same application that comes back.
So actually that's a variant on the basic authentication that can also be used. So you can either do that using basic authentication and send just your client ID and secret using that way, or just as part of the post.
Yes, well, I now use this because that's something I tried earlier at home, and I know it works.
Yeah.
Basic authentication will also work, but well, better not take too many risks. And then we also have to pass the same redirect URI, so it's an extra security step. So I just use the URI that comes in from when the user accesses this page. So these are all the parameters that are required. Now I can simply send the request. So I sent an HTTP post to the Google token URL, and with the parameters I specified before. This utility method will make sure that I get a 200 response code back and then will give me the parameters again. And if there's a problem, it will simply return null, so I can check for that. And then finally, the result that comes back from Google will be a JSON string, so I can then parse that string. And that will in fact be a map of the values that come back. And they are displayed lower in the page. Now I will restart the application server to be sure that everything is loaded again. And then I will start my flow again. Okay, I log in again. So it asks me the same question. Then I allow access and it still says invalid state, which means that I have a typo somewhere. Of course, I have to get back the same variable from the session or it won't work. Okay, so now the request was validated and my application has already contacted Google to get extra data, to get the access token. So here we see the parameter that Stan explained before. We have an expiry of 3600 seconds. A token type of bearer, a refresh token, an ID token, that's something that we will come back on later, it's for the OpenID Connect. And then also the access token will also be somewhere here. So the last part is the access token. And so now I can use the access token to access a service offered by Google. Offered by, so it's my application that wants to use something that Google offers.
Like information about the identity.
Yes, so the access.
Contacts,
yes, indeed. So for instance, I will try to get the user information. To do that, I have to send a GET request to another service, the Google User Info service. So that's the URI of that, so it's a Google API with name user info. It needs an authorization header for the bearer's token. And there we specify the access token. And then we simply call it. The user info is also a JSON string. Because it's not really relevant to our presentation, what is in it, I will simply display what's returned, and then we can move on. Should I save? So I'll allow access again. And so now we have also made the third call to Google. And you can see that it returns some basic information about my name and email address. Okay, then Stan will now move on to the next flow.
So thanks, Jan. Amazing that it actually is working.
Amazing that I only get code one problem.
Indeed. So as I said earlier, this was really the most complicated flow, but nevertheless one of the most widely used flows, though, because that's actually how you're writing applications, interacting with the third parties. There is another very common used flow. And unfortunately, for example, I heard that there was a problem with Evernote for the guys who are using Evernote on their iPad, iPhone. Evernote should have used this, the client-side web application flow. So what's the idea? The idea is that we have now a user, and he still wants, or she still wants to access a resource at the resource provider, but there is no application in the middle anymore. So we eliminate the intermediary there. It's just my TIC client, let's say an iOS application or Android application that wants to access a REST web service at the service provider or a resource provider site. Or it might even be, let's say, your standard Angular HTML5 web app that is sending or requesting data from your own backend using REST. And that's actually why we use this flow most of the time, actually, in order to prevent or to not train our user to enter passwords. So this is a lot simpler, as you'll see. So it all begins with, of course, the application, whether it's a browser or an iOS app or a native app, sending, again, a GET request to the authorization server containing more or less the same data as we saw previously. So it contains a client ID, it contains a redirect URI, it contains a scope, defining again what data I want to access, and also defining the response type. In this case, it is response type token, indicating that I don't want to get back an authorization code, but I want to get back an access token directly. So we're not doing this extra ping pong between the application and the client and the application anymore. Of course, still state, still important. So the authorization server at the resource provider side will authenticate the user, check whether, of course, the client ID is correct and the score redirect URI matches. And if that's not the case or the user doesn't allow access, it will just send again back a redirect containing error code as we have seen in the previous flow already. If the user allows the access, what I'll get back is, or the authorization server will construct a redirect and send it back to my browser or application containing the access token I requested, containing the time to live, so when it, how long it will live, so an hour, 3,600 seconds, the token type, and again the state. So I'll get back directly my token, and as an application, I can then use this access token again to just authorize my request going to the resource provider to access that particular resource. So it's a lot shorter. If this goes wrong, it's just the same process. I'll get back again just a JSON string indicating what went wrong. And if something goes wrong, I have to go, of course, back through my loop. I have to request back an access token. The user has to say, okay, I want to allow the application to get access to the data, and I'll go back to the entire process. So I don't have, in this case, a refresh token. So I just have one access token that has a limited lifespan that I can use to call APIs. And whenever that expires, the user has to go back through the process and say, yes, this application can have access to that particular service, and they will get back access to that. So it's a very limited flow. There are some very specifics, implementation specifics about this flow, but you, Jan, will cover that, right? So what's important to know here is that the credentials itself, so the user credentials, are never seen in the browser. So although the browser is, in this case, a TIC app, right? It's a JavaScript application, as one of the examples, it will only see the access token. It will never see the username and password of that particular user, because that's handled at the authorization server side, right? It has to authenticate with Google. It's never seen in the JavaScript code that is running in the browser. It's my own JavaScript code, and that's very important. I only have an access token. This access token is short-lived, and it is revocable, meaning that the user can say, no, I don't want this application to use this access token anymore. He can just revoke it. Let's say that I don't want to use OAuth, and then we're just using username and password, then probably my application will store the username and password. So this username and password is linked to my identity and not linked to the application I'm using. So meaning that if my iPhone or whatever gets stolen, I have to change my username and password, and I have to re-enter it in all the applications using the same resource at the resource provider site. It's most cases even worse, because as a user, I will probably be using the same username and password, or the same password at many sites, so I will have to go through the entire process of changing it everywhere. So that's a good thing about using OAuth, that at least it is contained to one application and contained to the scope I as a user have given the application access to. So it limits actually the window of attack of a hacker quite a lot. And that's also why you should use it. One of the biggest things or biggest problems here is that in the previous flow, there was a clear separation between the application and the browser, the user. Now I don't have that anymore. So there is for me no distinction anymore between the user and the application. I'm just acting completely on behalf of, and there is no intermediary. So that offers me less accountability from a resource provider's perspective, but yes, still better than username and password. The implementation specifics.
Okay, I will try to do this quickly. So here in this scenario, we have a JavaScript application, which means that we in fact only have HTML files. So there is no logic implemented on the server. In fact, there is no server, only one that can provide me with HTML files. I have added a number of constants here that we need, so client ID, the URLs, and also the scope that I want to use. You might have noticed that there is no client secret here. The reason is that it is impossible to protect the client secret because everything lives in the browser and well, you can simply get it out of there. Okay, so first I have to also create a unique state. This is JavaScript code, so I will simply use a quick shortcut to do that. It is simply a random number that I generated based on the current time. And then I quickly built the URL. First parameter that has to be added is the response type. This time I immediately want an access token, so I ask a token and not a code. And I also need a client ID. The next parameter is the redirect URI, so the URI of my page I'm calling. Scope. And finally, the state I just generated. Okay, thank you. And in fact, what this will do is so when I click on the link, login with Google, it will open a pop-up window with this URL, and then Google will do its thing there and immediately go back to the redirect URI. So I will already write this as well, so you can do the example in one go. What's important to realize is that we don't get the code and the state back as a parameter to the URL, but we get it back in the hash part, so or in fact the anchor part of the URL. There's a good reason for that, and that the browser will never pass these parameters back to the web server. They are only used in the browser, so they don't have to be passed to the web server. That also makes it a bit difficult to get to that. So we can easily ask it from the URL, but then we have to parse it ourselves because it is not a simple parameter. So there's I have a regular expression to parse that. So normally at the end of this code, we have a JavaScript object with all the parameters that are coming in. Because this lives in a pop-up window, I have to go back to the main window of my application, so with window.opener. And I will add a function there that accepts the parameters. And finally, I can close the pop-up window if this is done. And then here I will add this function. And I will just display the parameters, so I won't do any processing anymore. That in fact is the same as with the previous flow. You just have an access token and you can use it to... Okay, let's hope this works. So now if I click the login with Google, I get a pop-up window, which apparently doesn't do anything. See if I've forgotten something. In that case, I will just cheat and get a working example. So I did the example at home, and now I just copy-pasted it from the part that should work. Let's try again. Okay, so this time I simply ask permission to view my calendar. Okay, and I say allow access. And now the pop-up window does its magic. It parses the parameter that comes back. It closes itself, and then this one shows the access token. You also have the redirect URI, so Google will check that the URI it will redirect to matches the client ID that is given.
But here, you don't redirect it, you stay in the browser source. What would be a redirect URI for this client ID?
The pop-up window is redirect.
So in fact, I have two HTML files here. So the first one is the main application.
One of the things, it's an important thing that there is a user in between. So that's a security risk, because it's a user, but also it adds to the security because the user can validate whether he indeed wants to give this application access to this resource. So therefore, it's also important to make sure that the description is correct, etc., etc., that you, of course, have a trust relationship with the user.
Yeah, let's go a bit faster because problem with the flow.
There are two other important flows here, or they're less important, so we're not going to. They're actually less important because they're less good. So you should actually.
Well, this one is less important. The other one can be important.
Yeah, but this one is very bad actually.
Sorry about that, guys. Sticking to my part. I have to do it manually. Apparently, there's something went wrong.
So we're now talking about the resource owner password flow. So the idea is that the resource owner has a username and password and wants to trade that in for an access token. So this is more or less for, let's say, legacy applications that still want to do something with username and passwords. So what actually happens is that in my application, I want to allow access to the particular resource. And what will happen is, again, a post containing the client identifier and the client secret, the grant type password, and the username and the password of that particular user at the resource provider side. And what we will get back in response is, again, as you would expect, an access token. And this access token can then be used to do the actual API calls. That's how this flow works. Pretty straightforward. At least I'm not sending the username and password with every API call. So that's what I get in return. Normally I would have sent this information every time. Now I'm just sending it once to get an access token. I'm actually
using that access token for all my subsequent API calls. So that's my game.
So cloud use could, for instance, be a build for a human, but two computers in the HR, they have some PLC and
they're using that. No, that's actually the last flow. So as I said before, this is just the big warning, don't use it kind of flow, because actually it's supposed to be for legacy applications. It has some benefits above username and password, but there, as I said, better solutions available. And then we have the last flow, that's the client credentials flow, that is actually the use case that you explained, that we have, I have an application, that application just wants to access on its own behalf something at the resource provider side. So let's say, for example, I have an iPhone application and I'm storing photos, but not on the behalf of the user, but on behalf of the application itself, or a configuration file or whatever. That's where you would use this flow for. So the previous one was really always on behalf of a user. Now we're actually just doing it on behalf of an application, on behalf of ourselves. So what I am now constructing is just a post with grant type client credentials, a client ID and a client secret. That's the pre-known secret. And what I'll get back in return is just the same, an access token that is valid for a particular amount of seconds. So that's also a very simple flow for a very specific use case. I'm gonna very quickly, are there any questions with regard to these last two flows? Well, one of the main things that you might have mentioned or what you have seen is that there is quite some redirecting going on here, right? So we're actively piggybacking on the web infrastructure. Actually, we are more or less mandating a browser here. Now, the question is, can this also be used for native applications? Because, you know, almost half of our market is currently native, right? So writing iOS or Android applications. So why would we want to use OAuth together with native applications? Well, of course, it's a great fit to just call my backend application, right? Another nice thing is that I can use the entire infrastructure at my resource provider side. Just to give you an example, we at our company, we use Google Apps for mail access and whatever, but we have our own authentication service in place. It uses SAML integrated with Google. So that means that if I access my mail or Jan logs in, you will get a redirect to our own server where you have to authenticate using EID or whatever that we support, and we'll get a redirect get back to Google, and there you're authenticated correctly. It would be nice, of course, if I write an application that I could piggyback on the same infrastructure. So for example, if one of our clients uses the same infrastructure, when a user wants to log in, he has to log in at his own identity provider instead of Google. And that's perfectly supported in this flow. Because what I'm doing is actually I'm going through the authorization server at the resource provider that can handle the entire authentication process and will get me back an access token. So that's cool. And of course, what I'm doing with using OAuth is at least I'm not training the user to enter passwords in NAP. And if there is something you should do as a security professional, is this. Make sure you don't train the user to enter username and password, because it's the end of the world game, right? Of course, with this support for OAuth,
You also open the world to the other providers, because most identity or most service providers today already support OAuth, so it will fit in just quite nicely. The only problem with using, and I'm a bit shortcutting here, the biggest problem here is that, of course, when I am writing a native application, I don't necessarily have a web browser at my disposal, right? There are three things I can do. Either I can say, okay, in my native application, I'll just depend on my native browser. That's one thing I can do. So when going through the OAuth cycle, I'll make sure that the entire ping pong to get an access token is handled in the native browser. Well, when you talk to the UI designers that are more in charge in the native application world than in the enterprise world, they say, no, that's not a good user experience. We don't want this fiddling between applications going on. No, we don't like it. It should be a uniform user experience. Okay. So what you then come up with is WebFuse. Yes. What you can do in a native application is render a part in a, let's say, embedded web browser. That's what they call web views. And then the security guys comes in and says, okay, show me your security properties on this web view. Is the SSL certificate correct from Google? Can you show that to the user? Answer is no. Web views don't support that. So in a trade-off between security and usability, we really here completely on the usability side. Because, well, you can show whatever. You can show a Google-like window that uses a completely different security because it's hosted on a completely different server. The user will not know it. So that's also not really that a good solution. There then still is a third solution, and that third solution is just depend on the native support of your platform. For example, Android has native support for OAuth in its platform. So you can actually go to the native account manager to do the actual ping pong between your application and the resource provider. So that's actually what most do. Or you just not use or depend on the native features of the platform, but you depend on another application, another trusted application from the resource provider to go through the cycle. So for example, if I want to have access to data from Facebook, I can construct a redirect URI that identifies actually my application. Yeah? And I go through the Facebook application, the native Facebook application, to get me an access token. And then when this process is ready, the application, I'll get a redirect back through my underlying platform with an access token in response. The good thing here is that the user sees Facebook, the native Facebook application, he trusts this application and can use this application, of course, to authenticate at the Facebook site. So in this case, we're really more or less in the trust zone of the user. So that are the three possibilities that we have for native applications. So Jan, it's up to you to see what you still want to cover in 45 seconds.
Okay, so one thing I had prepared was OpenID Connect. I will quickly describe what it is. So one of the advantages of OpenID was that you could use identification, authentication, and that's something that is missing here. And that's why OpenID Connect was also invented. And when supported by your service provider, by your OAuth provider, you can also use identification with the same OAuth provider. So in that case, there's only one provider you need to address. There's only one protocol you need to learn. And it all becomes all more easy. In fact, there are three steps to do that. The first step is that you have to get an ID token. And to do that, you do in fact the same flow as a web application, but you have to modify a few parameters. So you have to change the response type, you have to add a scope for OpenID and optionally scopes to get the profile and the email address. And you can add a nonce that can be used against replay attacks. Then in the second step, you have to contact ExecID endpoint. And that's a very important step. And there you say, okay, I have gotten an ID token from you. Is this ID token still valid for me? And when you contact that endpoint, it will give you the same nonce back, so you can check that it belonged to the request you did earlier. It will also give you your own client ID back, so you can say, okay, it was my ID token that is returned. And it will also give you a user ID that you can then use in your own application to identify the user. So this is a very important step. And then optionally, that's what we did in the example before. There's a user info endpoint that you can use to get the email address and names and things like that. And that way you can get the identity information of the user. Okay, then quick some conclusions about our presentation. One thing that we can be certain of is that OAuth will be there to stay. So even if it has a number of disadvantages, it will be there and you better learn to live with it. An important thing to look out for is that there are still inconsistencies between the different providers. Hopefully in the next Mondays those will be eliminated, but it's best to test everything out very well, very carefully. OAuth also offers an interesting trade-off between security and user-friendliness or developer-friendliness. In order to appreciate that, we really have to look at the security paper about OAuth. But for instance, if you look at the use of bearer tokens versus cryptography, well, bearer tokens are easy to use for the developers, but are less secure. It also uses well-known security mechanisms that are used in all web applications, so you don't have to learn new things in order to use OAuth. And then finally, use libraries when you implement it yourself. So there are lots of libraries. I've added a few for Java and also one for Node.js. But for each platform, you can find a library to do OAuth, so don't write it yourself. I did it here as a quick demo, but my code wasn't really that good, so certainly don't do that.
I just have a question on that. Do you know a library for Objective-C on iOS?
Yeah, there is one, but I don't recall the name. There is I'll make sure that you see the slides when we publish the slides.
Thanks, I'll go search for it too.
Yep.
Okay, now last part, some references. So first one is an interesting read, the specification itself. And then the OAuth threat model and security considerations. That's really interesting if you're interested in the security implication of OAuth. It explains why certain choices were made and what the consequences of those choices are. And the third one is a book about getting started with OAuth. We also based part of our presentation on it, and it gives a very good introduction to what is OAuth, the different flows, and what's possible with it. We will post this presentation online. We will also make sure that the code examples are available so you can go through them. And then if there are still any questions, then please ask.
Thank you.